Hey guys, welcome back to Harbour Unboxed. On today's episode of Unboxing Boxes, I again just have two boxes that we'll be unboxing. But before we get to that, I thought I'd just discuss a few topics and a few things that relate to what we've been doing recently. The top of the agenda is the Thermaltake riser cable that we looked at last week in the Core P3 build, where I had some problems there, and quite a few other people have as well, evidently. I spoke to Thermaltake on Friday, and I mentioned the issue. And as a few of you actually pointed out in that video, the timing was quite coincidental because Thermaltake just announced plans for a new and improved riser cable. And they assured me that that was coming. They've shown it off on their YouTube channel, so if you're interested, check that out. But basically, they will be getting me two of them. And from what I've seen so far, they look very, very similar to that Lian Li cable that I purchased for $120 to solve my problem. They just won't be a couple of feet long like that one was. So that's good news, I think. Well, first of all, we've got to see how well they work. They look like they'll work well. And then the other big, big issue is the price. So I don't know if they're going to be able to offer properly shielded cables that are quite durable for the 100... I think it's 120 US they're asking for their current cables. So, I mean, if they can deliver it for that price or similar to that price, then that'd be fantastic. But, yeah, since all the other ones are well north of $100, I'm not sure what to expect, really. But they said as soon as they get some in, they'll send them my way and give me all the appropriate information. So you'll probably see me playing with the new Thermaltake riser cables sometime in the near future on this unboxing segment. Moving on. I've been quite busy over the last few weeks, or it's been quite disorganized. You haven't really noticed on the channel, we've done a pretty good job of getting videos out. But at the moment, we're downstairs in my house, and that's where I've built the studio in this. It's a 6 meter by 4 meter room, so it's not huge, but it's not small. And we've got, obviously, I've built these shelves here, which is our backdrop, and they're good for storing all our boxes. They're quite high, they go up quite a few meters. We've got a heap of crap over here, which I might show you, but it's not really worth seeing. And then my personal computer and the benchmark computer, just one of them, is sort of crammed down in the corner over here. Because upstairs, where I have my bigger office, where I normally do most of my work, I'm changing it all because I'm doing film now, or a lot more film than I was, since I was doing none about a month ago. But basically, the office was a bit of a mess upstairs. I'd purpose-built it for what I was doing, and then as that slowly changed, we ripped things out, changed things, and it just became a horrible mess. So I've ripped it all apart, completely trashed the whole room, and I've been rebuilding what'll be an alternate setup there, which will probably be more of a benchmark set, I'd say. So when we do those big benchmark videos, I'll probably present them up there, and when we do more hands-on testing and stuff, it'll make more sense to do it up there in the lab. I filmed how it was, the mess, so you'll get to see what we came from, and I've been filming it as I've been modifying and, you know, building things, not so much, you know, the hands-on stuff, just been showing the stage as quickly as I try to get through it. I'm hoping to have it done quite soon, but yeah, these things can take longer than anticipated, so we'll see how we go, but probably next month I'll start releasing some footage in the unboxing series of how the office is going and, yeah, give you guys an update on all that sort of stuff. And on that note, I do have plans to sort of change the channel ever so slightly. Not drastically, like the benchmarks will all be the same and all the video content will be much the same, but just have a more personal approach with the channel. So show you guys way more behind the scenes sort of stuff because we haven't really done any of that to this point. And you guys have been asking. So, and that's a big reason why I've decided to renovate the office upstairs to make it more, basically better for that sort of stuff. So we can do more hands-on stuff and more behind-the-scenes stuff. So there'll be, yeah, that'll be sort of one direction that I plan to take the channel in next year. So that should be fun. And I think that pretty much covers everything for now. So we probably should start unboxing some boxes. I'll start with this bigger one. It's another, I had to rip the shipping label off it, but it looks like it's another Logitech box. Alright, what do we have here? It's definitely a Logitech box. It looks like it's Logitech's new Z337 speakers. Cool. 80 watts. I assume that's peak power. Bluetooth. I might have to do some quick research on these so I can give you some information. But before I do that, let's take them out of the box and have a look. It's quite a small box, so I'm not sure how big the speaker system is. Presumably smaller than the box. There we go. It looks like we've got a little controller here. They must be the satellite speakers. It is a 2.1 system, from what I can tell on the box. Sit that there. Let's have a look what we got here. So it looks like it's a nice, small, little compact 2.1 system. Logitech have done plenty of nice, compact 2.1s in the past. So we have a little subby here. There's four RCAs on the back. I'd say at least two of them's for connecting the satellite speakers. And there's also a 3.5mm auxiliary input, which we would probably connect from your PC. Right. I'll move that to the side. So here's the controller. Yep, pretty simple. Left is lower, right is higher, I think. Bluetooth button for connecting up your phone or tablet or whatever. So that's pretty cool. I like how a lot of these new desktop speakers are taking advantage of Bluetooth, and with everyone using their smartphones so much now, that's very handy. And the on-off button. So, oh, and you've got a headphone jack as well. And it looks like there's a reasonable amount of cable there, so you should be able to get it to a nice spot on your desk. Yeah, it's pretty cool. And then you can turn up the gain on the bass, the subwoofer here. Minimum, maximum, so that's pretty cool. Very, very surprisingly light, but I mean it is small. And there we go, one of the satellite speakers. They're wrapped in a... It's almost like a sort of a metallic-y looking material. Dark grey, not quite black, but yeah, look, they look pretty cool. So there's two of those. So yeah, there you go, the new Logitech Z337s. They cost about $100 Aussie, so that's pretty cheap really, assuming that they sound quite good. The whole system's rated at 40 watt RMS, so that's pretty decent. I mean, yeah, it's definitely gonna, your neighbors will know about it if you crank them up. The two satellites feature 3-inch convex dome drivers, 8 watt RMS each, and then the subwoofer has a 5.25-inch front firing dome driver. So there you go, the new Logitech desktop speakers that are reasonably priced and they support Bluetooth. So you may see a review on them shortly. The next and last box. Ah, cool, you guys will like, well, some of you guys will like this anyway. We have Gigabyte's GTX 1050 Ti graphics card. And we have Gigabyte's 1050 graphics card. So that is the 2GB model, so that's the standard memory, and the 4GB 1050 Ti. And they're both the G1 gaming model. So we'll take them out of the box and have a bit of a look at them. Previously, I've had the base model MSI. They're just, yeah, the OC models, the 1050 and 1050 Ti from MSI, which is what we used in our original review, and they're tiny little cards, but they work quite well, and they both meet the MSRP. But these G1 gaming cards should be, yes, they are, a bit more substantial. So again, apart from the graphics card, there's nothing else in the package. So what did I open here? This is the Ti model. So there you go. The G1 Gaming 1050 Ti. This does have a 6-pin connector, so I haven't used a 1050 graphics card with an external PCIe connector, power connector, so that's cool. And it also has a full-length backplate, so I know a lot of you guys will like that as well. So that's pretty cool for a budget card. Hopefully the price reflects that it's still a budget card. And it looks like, wow, there's three HDMI outputs. Yep, three HDMI outputs and a single display port and a dual link DVI port. If I can get the cover off it. So hopefully you guys can see that. I might have to add some B-roll over it, we'll see. Yeah, so I mean the cooler on it is way, way bigger than what's on the MSI card. So I would assume or expect this thing to run very, very cool. I'll definitely be reviewing this card probably next week. I'll get around to doing that. And we'll see if the 1050 model is the same. Obviously, it has got the 1050 GPU and only 2GB of DDR5 memory, or GDDR5 memory. It's looking very similar. Very similar indeed. The camera battery just went flat, so hopefully not too much of that got cut out. I had a bit of a problem with that last week. I did about 4 takes or something because I had the mic preamp went flat, and the mic went flat, and the camera went flat, and bloody batteries. Do something about them. Anyway, where was I? That's right, I was talking about the vanilla 1050 G1 Gaming 2GB graphics card. And it looks like, again, you get three HDMI outputs, one display port, one dual link DVI port, full backplate on the card. It looks like the same, exact same cooler. You get another 6-pin PCIe power input. Looks like the same fan setup, fan shroud, LED lights, the whole lot. So that's a pretty serious graphics card. What's the MSRP on the 1050 again? I think it's $110 US. So I'll have a quick look at pricing now and let you guys know what I find. So yeah, this card is $205 Aussie or $140 US. And I have to say that's pretty pricey for a vanilla 1050. I'm not... Yeah, US availability is not great at the moment. So that $30 over the MSRP may come down as availability picks up. But yeah, at the moment, $140 US for this card. That's expensive. And the 1050 Ti... Don't know how to say this. It's currently $170 US, which is, as many of you guys know, RX 470 money. So again, not sure about that one, or 245 Aussie. So they are good looking cards, but yeah, that's quite a premium to pay over this model, which should deliver pretty similar performance. So this one is the 1050 2GB model. And this is the 2GB model. So this one you're paying $110 for. This one you're paying $130 US for. Yeah, so hopefully this one's worth it. Maybe it overclocks better performance. I don't know. Based on what we've seen from Pascal with the 1060, the 1070, the 1080, and so on, that, yeah, adding more power input and stuff doesn't really help you squeeze much more performance out. So I don't think it's going to justify that kind of percentage increase in price, but we'll find out. That's what the review's for. So we've got two graphics card reviews, which will probably be coming up next week. Sit. There you go. Probably do a Logitech speaker review because they look quite interesting and quite reasonably priced, I think. I haven't done a huge amount of research yet on what's available, but $100 Aussie for a system of that quality seems pretty good to me. And yeah, this week on the channel, I have an interesting video. I hope it's interesting anyway. Basically, it's a look at PCI Express performance using high-end graphics cards, looking at the third generation, second generation, or first generation PCIe specifications or revisions. So you obviously have, I think it's 4 gigs for the first revision, 8 gigs for the second revision, and 16 gigabytes per second for the third revision. In the past, we found that doesn't make much difference to performance, but I recently been updating all my CPU results in the wake of the new upcoming AMD and Intel processors in late December, probably January. And I was testing the old Sandy Bridge stuff and noticed it was quite a bit slower than I was expecting with graphics cards such as the Titan XP in relation to Skylake and whatnot, like quite a lot slower. And part of that was to do with the PCIe bandwidth, or at least I thought I did. You'll have to watch the video to find out. But yeah, not a huge amount of testing, but it's kind of interesting. Yeah, and that's what's coming this week. Also, I'll probably get up a review of Samsung's new 960 Evo SSD, and I won't just provide benchmark numbers and graphs for that. I'll actually do some screen capture stuff using an external device to show, like, compare it to maybe like the Crucial MX300 and even a hard drive, show the system booting up, loading things like Adobe Premiere, a couple of games and stuff. So that should be pretty interesting as well. And then I should probably get a review on that Western Digital WD Blue 1TB SSD as well. So I don't know whether that'll be later this week or I'll squeeze that into next week. We'll see. And I think that's about everything for this week anyway. And then there's some cool stuff coming the week after when I finally get around to doing that. And yeah, hopefully on next week's episode as well, I'll show you some footage of the office and what I'm doing and up there. So that should be pretty interesting. I think you guys will like that. And that about wraps this one up. I'm your host, Steve. Thanks for watching, guys. And I will see you throughout the week with more exciting content. Bye.